Very excited to talk about A Long Petal of the Sea, which I absolutely adored.
Thank you for reading it. Most people who interview me have not read it.
They haven't read it yet?
No.
Do they just guess?
No, yeah.
Yeah.
They read the flap and that's it.
And they start from there?
Yeah.
The first thing I was told actually when I knew I was going to be able to do this interview was that Victor is a real person, which mm-hmm. you also say in your introduction. I wondered if you could tell me about how you came to know Victor in Venezuela.
Well, the character of the book is called Victor Dalmau, and he's a Spanish refugee that escapes from the civil war in Spain. He's a real person. He was called Victor Pei in real life, mm-hmm. and he was a friend of my family, but I met him, he was older than me, so I was not very close to him mm-hmm. until much later, after 1973, when we had the military coup in Chile. He was arrested. I ended up living in exile in Venezuela. And when he was released, he came to Venezuela as a refugee for the second time in his life. Wow. And there we met, and he told me the story of his life. And I kept that story in my memory for 40 years. But I remembered everything he had told me, and we kept in touch. So when I decided to write the book, it was very easy, because it's recent history, it's easy to find the documentation, and I had him. So we were emailing back and forth several times a week. Unfortunately, he died 6 days before I could send him the manuscript dedicated to him. He was 103 years old.
Wow.
And he was totally lucid.
And happy to talk about all those papers.
Yeah, but he didn't know I was writing about him. He knew I was writing about the story of the Winnipeg, the ship and all that. But I didn't want to tell him he was the protagonist, because I wanted that to be a surprise. And the guy goes and dies, dies in his sleep 6 days before.
You think 103 years old, he could have held on for six more days.
Six more days, yeah, what the heck? I start all my books on January 8th, and usually I don't stop until I have finished.
Oh, wow.
And so I started on January 8th a couple of years ago, and I just wrote the story in a year. Very easy to write, because, as I said, the story is whole. I didn't have to invent the story. The Winnipeg existed, the refugees existed. These people who came to Chile as refugees, I know them. Mm-hmm. So it was easy.
You say in your acknowledgements you had to imagine very little.
Very little.
Yeah.
Dialogues and relationships, and sometimes pick up two people to create one character, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And A Long Petal of the Sea opens in 1939, which is at the end of the Spanish Civil War, and very much put in the depth of war, very brutal situation. Lots of people trying to do the best for their families, lots of people trying to help as well. When you started writing, did you know that that was the point where you're going to start? Was that where his stories began?
Yes, I knew that, because how could I justify the refugees? Why were they refugees? Well, because they couldn't stay at home. Mm-hmm. And that's the story of all refugees. They have to leave. So I had to explain why they had to leave. Mm-hmm. And so I sort of explained the Civil War, but without going into much detail, because the story really begins when they come to Chile.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point, because people seem to forget a lot of the time that refugees are fleeing from something.
Who would leave their home? Mm-hmm. Everything that is familiar to them, sometimes their families, their jobs, their language, to go to a place where they will be received with hostility, unless they are running away for their lives.
And there's a very poignant scene right at the very, very beginning of the book where Victor restarts a heart, and that's a motif that's carried throughout the course of the book. Was that something that actually happened, that he restarted the heart? Was
no,
that an image?
That I sort of came up with that idea, and then I asked a couple of cardiologists, is this possible?
Yeah.
And they said, yes, not frequently done, but but it is possible. The book begins with hundreds of wounded soldiers, combatants, that are coming in trains, in trucks, to the Estación del Norte, up in the north of Barcelona. And among them, there is a young kid, because now the boys were fighting the war, 14, 15 years old, and there's a wounded kid. And so Victor, who is a paramedic, he's not a doctor yet, he takes the bandages out and sees that he has an open wound, and the ribs and the sternum have been shattered by the bullet, but the heart is intact. And the boy is dying. So the boy dies and he sees the heart that stops beating. And then he doesn't know why. He puts three fingers inside and starts rhythmically massaging the heart, and the heart starts again, and the boy lives. And that motif of the beating heart, of the open heart, of the bleeding heart, is all along the book.
Yeah, I love seeing it kind of come back again and again. There are lots of journeys in this book. There's the journey to France, there's the journey to Chile, there's the journey to Venezuela, and the journeys kind of become more fractured as everyone goes to different places. But one that really stood out to me was Aitor and Rosaire's treacherous journey to France, because it really reminded me of a trip I took with UNHCR, the UN Refugee Agency, to Jordan. We met Syrian refugees, and many of whom had just come across the border 72 hours earlier, and had been waiting at the border for 4 months or so, these really long periods. When you were writing, were you thinking of all these very contemporary things happening as well? Did that come into it?
Well, I knew the story of the Winnipeg and the refugees for 40 years. Why did I need to write it now? Because the theme of refugees and displaced people is in the air. And it's a global problem today. And people think that it can be solved building walls. But, you know, in the world we live today, everything is global. Drugs, guns, money, everything, except people. And people are desperate sometimes, and they need to find a place where they can feel safe. And you cannot stop that desperate people with walls. We have to find a global solution that starts by trying to solve the problems in the countries of origin. Why people leave? Because something is happening in their place of origin. It could be war, crime, extreme poverty, corrupt governments that make life impossible. In the border with the Mexico-United States, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of Central Americans, mostly from Nicaragua, Guatemala, and El Salvador, which are is called the Triangle of the North, and it's taken over by gangs and narcos. And the police and the military are involved in the drugs and everything else. So there's no safety for anybody. And children leave. So in that desperate situation that we live today, the world needs to get together and find a solution. You work in that.
Yeah, I was so afraid in that moment where they're traveling, they meet the smuggler, because I was like, their lives are in his hands.
And often the smugglers will rape the women, will abandon the children, if anything happens, they will just abandon them in the middle of the desert.
I thought Rosaire was such a fantastic character. I loved her so much. I loved her steadfastness. I loved how she was faced with all these challenges. And she says, you know, I've been working mountains with goats. I can get through this journey. But it's not without being close to the suffering and how hard it is too. Just because she's very strong doesn't mean she doesn't experience that suffering.
You know, people ask me, how do you invent these strong women in your books? I don't have to invent them. I have a foundation and we work with women and girls mostly. And I get to meet the most extraordinary people. If you ask me, do you know any weak woman? I would have to think carefully, because most of the women I know are extraordinary. And the other thing is that we don't know how strong we are until we are tested. I have seen that in my own life, that there have been situations in which I thought, I will never survive this. And then I realized that I not only survived it, but I became stronger. And I think that happens to Rosaire in the book.
Could you talk a bit about your own journey and fleeing Chile and to Venezuela?
We had a military coup in Chile in 1973. And we had a dictatorship that lasted 17 years. Shortly after the coup, I realized that I couldn't stay in Chile because, you know, Chile was a very long democracy, very solid democracy in Latin America. We had no idea what a military coup was, or a dictatorship. We had no idea. So when the country changed completely in 24 hours, it took us a while to understand the new situation. And I, myself and many other people, got involved in trying to help victims of repression, trying to get people out of the country, hiding people, mm-hmm. getting information out of the country. I wasn't a hero at all. Many people were doing this. But then we learned that you could pay with your life for this. And so there was a moment when I felt very afraid. And I left thinking, okay, I'll spend a couple of months away and then I'll come back. But, and I went to Venezuela, which was one of the very few countries where you could go at the time in Latin America, because the whole of Latin America, we had dictatorships everywhere. And so I went to Venezuela, and a month later, my husband decided that it wasn't safe for me to go back, and it was better to just all reunite in Venezuela. And he came with the children. And we lived in Venezuela, always thinking that we would go back, for 13 years. The average time, as you know, that a refugee spends away from home is between 17 and 25 years. And many never, ever go back. And I think in that sense, for other reasons, it has been my case. Because when I could return to Chile in 1990, when we had democracy again, I was married to an American. I was bringing my children to the United States. So it was too late to go back. I've been going back all the time, but I don't belong there anymore.
Yeah.
And I don't belong in California either. I'm always a foreigner.
Yeah, you talk about that belonging in your introduction letter, and that was a question that I was thinking about as I was reading, that sense of belonging and where we belong.
Because I live in the United States, in California, where we have so many Latino immigrants, yeah. I get often asked, by young people especially, what do I have to do to adapt, to belong? And I said, you don't have to belong fully. Mm. You can have what you brought with you and take the best that the United States can offer you. You don't have to choose. Mm-hmm. Get everything. Yeah. One foot there, one foot here, and as much as you can get, be bicultural. That's great. Mm. And in the book, they also have those many moments that immigrants have of looking back and saying, maybe I should have stayed, maybe it would be better if I belong there. Mm-hmm. And there is a point in the book when Victor Dalmau, after having spent 30 years in Chile and years in exile, Franco dies, and he decides to go back to his country. So he goes back to Spain and doesn't recognize the country, because for 40 years it had lived under uniforms and cassocks. Mm-hmm. It's a fascist Catholic dictatorship, for God's sake. And then he doesn't have any friends there, he doesn't have any family, he doesn't recognize the streets, nothing. And he realizes he doesn't belong there and goes back to Chile.
I was wondering also, in that time when you went to Venezuela or even when you ended up in California, was there any specific kind of support when you received or act of kindness that made a difference to you as a refugee arriving in?
When I got to Venezuela, Venezuela was a rich country, one of the richest in the world because of the oil boom. It was an open country. Anybody could come and get your papers easily. It was generous, happy country. Because there was money and there was wonderful weather and people are beautiful, life was great. Yeah. So if you went to the beach, you saw these studs with mini
speedos
that you could see everything through the speedo. And the most beautiful women in the world. All the beauty pageants were worn by Venezuelan women. So it was a beautiful place to be in. And I was coming from a somber country in a dictatorship that half the people were living in terror. And coming to this open, happy society. So I felt, first of all, shocked. Mm-hmm. I thought that you couldn't be like that, mm-hmm. it was irresponsible. In this dark world in which we live, why would you be happy?
Yeah.
Yeah, but Venezuelans don't think that way. So thank God they don't. Yeah. And so I at the beginning it was very hard, but as soon as I could connect to some Venezuelan families and get, then I was totally welcomed, and that was wonderful. And then when I moved to the United States, I didn't have a problem because I fell in lust with a guy, and I decided to spend a week with him. So I was living in Venezuela, mm-hmm. so I spend a week in his house without an invitation.
Perfect.
Perfect. And then I decided it was pretty good. So I forced him into marriage. I needed a visa. So of course, if I needed a visa, he had to marry me. So he did eventually, not willingly, but he married me. And we remained married for 28 years. But the fact that I was married to an American helped me, because he sort of opened the doors. For example, for me to open the faucet and hot water would come out instead of mud, that was fantastic. The fact that you could pay a bill with a check on the mail, that the mail worked, all that, he introduced me into civilization. That was good.
Yeah, that was a good entry point for it. That's a good point to come into my next question, because at every stage of the book, both in war and in these moments of transition, we see that there's a squeeze on resources, and we see the consequences of that on medical care, but also on day-to-day life. And there's a lovely moment where they get very excited about tobacco. This is very much in stark contrast with how the upper classes or wealthier countries are doing. Was that quite an intentional contrast that you drew between the two?
Yes, I thought it was very important to establish from the very beginning, as soon as they get to Chile, that Chile is a cake of many layers. Social classes in Chile are like castes in India, almost as rigorous as in India. And you can go down in the social scale, never up, unless you are a renowned artist, for example, a beauty.
Yeah.
And that's it. Because if you make money, you can do everything that the upper classes do, but you are never quite accepted because you are a nouveau riche, you know. Yeah. That has changed. But at the time when the book, when the story happens, which is the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, that was very much the world I lived in. And I thought it was very important to establish that, because when these Spaniards come, they don't know anything about the social classes in Chile, but the people in Chile didn't know where to place them because they didn't quite belong here or there, and that would be established in time, depending on if Victor becomes a very well-known doctor, so he can climb in the social scale more than others that had come in the same Winnipeg. And that was for me important to establish, because I think it's one of the awful things about Chile.
And do people in Chile know about the Winnipeg broadly, or is that lesser known?
I think it happened so long ago that some people know about it, but in September last year, it was the 80th anniversary of the arrival of the ship, and there was an exhibit, and it was on TV, and so many people know about it.
It feels quite parallel to the Windrush arrivals that we have here, like this big boat of immigration that a lot of people don't grow up learning about unless they're related to, or it's part of their family history, or it's part of that history that has to be taught at home, because it's sadly not taught in our schools.
So well, in Spain, for example, very few people know about the Winnipeg, because so many people left Spain and found refuge in Mexico, in Argentina, in other countries in Europe, that that the Winnipeg is just 2,000 people that went to Chile, so what? But when I was on the radio, in some radio programs launching the book last year, many people who called had parents or grandparents that had participated in the Civil War. Some of them had died, and some of them had become refugees.
Wow. So they knew.
It's a very present history.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this also brings me on to Pablo Neruda, who's a very key figure in the book, having helped charter the Winnipeg. But you weave him into the story. He feels very present in the poems that you use, excerpts from poems for each chapter. You've kind of have a long, ongoing relationship with Pablo Neruda in terms of...
With his poetry.
With his poetry. I'm sorry.
I wish it
just
was
to be clear.
First of all, he's dead.
It would be a bit inappropriate. But how did you select the passages for each chapter, or did that just come from a place of you knowing...
No, I don't know his poetry by heart, But I have a book, the complete works of Pablo Neruda, and it's like the Bible. You open it in any page and you can use it. And so I write the chapter. What's the chapter about? It's about war and blood and wounded people. There is, I'm sure Pablo Neruda has something about that. So I start scanning the book and of course I find something.
Yeah, it's got something for everything. Yeah. And what is it about his work that you love so much that you come back to?
Well, I live in English in the United States and I write in Spanish. So, and I start all my books on January 8th. So by after New Year, let's say January 2nd, I start reading Pablo Neruda's poetry and some other poets in Spanish also. Not because I love poetry that much, but because I need the language. I need to get back the flavor, the rhythm of the sentences, the metaphors, the imagery that Pablo Neruda offers. Mm-hmm. And so in a way that helps me a lot when I start writing.
Mm-hmm. I totally understand that. My mum's Mexican and I grew up speaking English and Spanish. And there are times when I have to get myself into that Spanish rhythm.
Yes. You know, when I go back to Chile, let's say I spend a couple of weeks in Chile speaking Spanish, I come back and I can't speak English. Yeah. I can't remember the words. I stumble upon everything. And then, but at the beginning, when I go to Chile, I have to be very careful not to introduce any English words because that's so snobbish and so awful that I can't do it.
Yeah. I find that my jaw hurts the first day I get back because I just speak so much faster in Spanish. Yeah. There's a period that both Roser and Victor spend in internment in France, in the concentration camps there. Time among the soldiers, and that actually really reminded me of the period Alba spends as prisoner at the end of House of the Spirits, but also of all the women around them that provide support and comfort and humour and community, really. Can you talk a bit about what community gives the characters in A Long Petal of the Sea? Because we see that come up again and again.
Well, I think one of the most important problems of being an immigrant and being a refugee is that you lose your community. You lose your family, your community, your nation, your tribe. And then you feel so vulnerable, so lost, until you make a new community. And in this case, what you are referring to, when the French put all these people in these concentration camps in the beaches. They put men and women and children together, everybody together. No shelters, nothing. And the women suffered terribly because many of them were raped, not so much by the prisoners, but by the guards. Mm. And many of the children died. They died of exposure and hunger. And there were pregnant women and women who were ready to give birth and newborn babies among the refugees. There was a woman who was a nurse, a Swiss nurse, called Elisabeth Eidelbenz. And she had been in the civil war in Spain working with children, trying to help the children. And when she realized what was going on in the camps, she tried to save the pregnant women so that they could give birth in a safe place. And she sort of rented a big house and got these women out of the camps, and she later created a larger maternity in a place called Elba, which is, the building still stands. It's a museum today, and I visited it. She saved 600 children from real death. And then she started helping Jewish women, getting them into a safe place when they were pregnant, and Gypsy women too. So there was this community of women helping each other that was extraordinary. She couldn't keep the women for long in the maternity, only until they gave birth. And then she had to return them to the camps, knowing that in the camps the babies would die.
Yeah.
So then she tried to create some shelters in the camps where the mothers could breastfeed and where they could keep the children. But the conditions were horrific.
Yeah, wow. There are a lot of very divided moments in families and in the countries as well that you feature in the novel that felt very kind of contemporary. People stepping away from religion in that period, people always also having different opinions about the refugees and what the best route is for their country. Is that something that you think is always happening?
Yes, yes. In any society, you have many, many tendencies. And sometimes, for example, in the United States today, the country is totally polarized, divided. You can't even talk. I'm a Democrat. I can't talk to a Republican. And a Republican cannot talk to me. So that's how divided we are right now. But in this, in the book, that happens all the time, because there are the family of Ophelia, one of the characters in the book, is a high-class, wealthy Chilean family. And of course they are against the refugees. They are Catholics, and they don't want any leftists coming to the country. And the, notoriously, the Republicanos were atheists or agnostics, so they didn't want them. Plus, they were lower class. I mean, they were not the same, the same class. So within the family, there are also different tendencies, let's say. And it happens all the time. It happened in my family and in every family.
I love Felipe's Club of the Enraged. I was like, I know those people.
Met those people. It's so easy, theoretically, to be enraged.
Yeah.
But then when the time comes to really practice what you are talking about, they don't do it.
Something you do so wonderfully, I think, in your novels is show how love can change for different people and grow, and there's that passion, and then sometimes it's lust, and then lust sometimes turns into love, sometimes it's for one person, for another. It feels very honest, I think, the way you talk about love.
And well, I have a lot of experience. I have had so many lovers in my life.
Scrolls of them. Yeah, I just wondered if you could just talk for a moment. I know we've been talking about some quite heavy topics. If you could talk about passion in the
this couple, Roser and Victor, they get married. Roser is Victor's brother's fiancée, and she's pregnant. And Guillem, the brother, dies in the war. And so she's left with a baby. And then Victor wants to bring them in the Winnipeg to Chile, get out of Europe, because he sees that the war is coming in Europe. And Pablo Neruda is choosing families to get on the Winnipeg. So they decide to get married and present themselves as a family. And that's how they get in the ship. So it's a marriage that starts as a marriage of convenience. Then it develops into a long and beautiful friendship that goes through many stages, and many things happen to them in that time. And then it ends up, when they are old, in a passionate love affair. Mm. And I'm asked all the time, but do you really think that old people can be passionately in love?
Of course.
Look, I'm 77 and I just got married. So I know it's possible.
Yeah, definitely possible.
And what's the difference between falling in love at 77 or at 20? Mm. The only difference is that at my age, you don't have any time to waste. Mm. No, you really don't. How many years do I have with Roger? 5, 6 before he gets demented and I have to put him in a nursing home?
And make the most of it.
I have to make the most of it. So there's no time, no time for pettiness, for jealousy, for little games, for... No, you just, you have to let go of all the little things and concentrate on what's important. And that's what we are doing. And it's working great. I was married the first time 29 years, the second time 28 years. If I had known this, maybe I wouldn't have 2 divorces in my back. I would have behaved better.
Yeah. What would your message be to people who have recently become refugees, or the communities that are housing them, welcoming them?
I don't have messages. I have questions only. But every experience is different. I have been a political refugee, but in excellent circumstances, because Venezuela really welcomed me. And that's not the case for most people. And this is a very, very hard experience, and a very long one, and a very sad one. And what I would try to tell people is that find friends. Try to find friends among the people, the community where you are. Without other human beings helping you, it's impossible to make it.
if we throw it over to questions, if anyone has any questions in the audience. Isabel starts her novels on the 8th of January, and is there any significance to that date?
Discipline. First, I started my first book on January 8th, and it was a lucky book, so I decided to start the second book the same date for luck, and then the third, and now I can't change it because I'm sure that if I change the day, something horrible will happen. But also discipline. My life is complicated. I need to have a few months a year with no other activity but writing. And the only way I can do it is by having a day to start. Everybody around me knows that, and they respect it. So that's great. My new husband will have to learn.
The question was, could you tell us something about the role of stories in real life?
I think that the way we can connect is through stories. When we hear about refugees in the border, we hear numbers, statistics. We don't see faces, we don't know the names, we have not heard the stories. But the moment you hear the story, that person becomes you. You could be that person. You are the other. And so I think that's the value of storytelling, that you can really be the other. I will be introducing an author very soon, Colm McCann. He's from Ireland, and he's a very good writer. And one of the things that I've learned is because he expresses very well, is that the role of the fiction writer is empathy, is to become the other by telling the story. Mm. So I think that's the most important thing. And I do that all the time. When I meet someone, especially a man, I say, tell me your story. Guys love to talk about themselves. So then you have them, you know. But when you hear the story, they become people, and then you can connect.
So the question was, are there any other characters in the book that you knew? Or you
well, I have known several of the passengers of the Winnipeg that I interviewed for the book. Or that I have known from before. Some of them are very well known in Chile. Great artists in Chile came from the Winnipeg. Victor Pay's sister was a pianist, and she became the dean of the School of Music in Chile. So she inspired the character of Roser.
The question was, lots of your books are read as part of university courses by students. Does that change the way you write because you know that students are going to dig into your writing?
Not at all. I wasn't even aware that they are studying it. No. But I want to tell a story. And each story has a way of being told. It has its own demands, its own challenges. I cannot repeat the formula that worked for another book. I have to recreate everything. But I try to write as honestly as possible that story, and I don't ever think of who is going to read it or in which circumstances. Just the fact that the books will be translated into languages that I can't even place in the map, gives me a sort of freedom. They don't belong to me anymore. Who knows what they translate? You know, I used to translate from English romantic novels, and I changed the endings and I changed the dialogue because they were so stupid. So I'm sure some other translators are doing that to my books and improving the books, probably. And that's fine. The stories just leave, and they don't belong to me. So I don't care about the voyage of each one of the books, what happens to the books. I can't follow that. This is a very shy audience.
So British. So British. Isabel did an event at the South Bank Centre last night, and it sounds like you had lots of Latinos there.
No, but not only Latinos. A lot of people were asking, and half of them I couldn't understand the accent. And excellent questions,
really
excellent questions. One of the questions was about why does the book begin with the doctor massaging the heart? And it was about, so I explained that the whole theme of the book is that you live with an open heart. Mm. And that means that you take risks. And you will suffer, yes, so what? Everybody suffers. Mm. And if you don't take risks, if you don't live with an open heart, you have a little life. Yeah. So that's the whole point of the book.
I think that's the perfect note to end on, so I'm just going to end it there. Thank you so much, Isabel Allende.
Thank you.